Hello, and welcome again to another session of Cats in the Corner Office. We really appreciate you joining us today. In front of a live audience, we're really delighted to have alumni, students, recent alumni, all here to join us for this conversation. This event is brought to you by the UA Alumni Association's Alumni Career and Professional Development Lab. The Career Lab helps alumni find jobs, make connections, and advance their careers. So for more information on the Alumni Career Lab, you can visit alumnicareerlab.com, and you can also follow us on Twitter at HireACat. Today's conversation is being recorded and will be available on demand through the UA Alumni Association. As we talk with Dr. Robbins, questions are encouraged at any time. So we encourage audience members to write their questions down, share them with the staff who will come around, and we'll be providing Dr. Robbins with those questions. I think that's all the direction I have now. Let's get started. So welcome to Cats in the Corner Office, our online speaker series featuring outstanding, accomplished alumni, faculty, and staff. I'm Melinda Burke, President of the Alumni Association, and I'm very pleased today that our guest is President Robert Robbins. Dr. Robbins assumed the position of President of the University of Arizona on June 1st, 2017. Previously, he served as CEO of the Texas Medical Center in Houston from 2012 to 2017. He significantly enhanced TMC's commitment to collaboration, introducing 5 cross-institutional research initiatives centered on innovation, genomics, regenerative medicine, health policy, and clinical research. Prior to his time in Houston, Dr. Robbins served as professor and chairman of the Department of Cardiovascular Surgery at Stanford University School of Medicine, founding director of the Stanford Cardiovascular Institute, President of the International Society of Heart and Lung Transplantation, President of the Western Thoracic Surgical Association, President of the American Heart Association Western States Affiliate, President of the Bay Area Society of Thoracic Surgeons, and Chair of the American Heart Association Cardiovascular Surgery and Anesthesia Council. And there are even other roles, but I'll stop there. He's an internationally recognized cardiac surgeon. He has focused his clinical efforts on acquired cardiac diseases with a special expertise in the surgical treatment of congestive heart failure and cardiothoracic transplantation. His educational background includes a BS in chemistry from Millsaps College, a medical degree from University of Mississippi, general surgical training at University of Mississippi, cardiothoracic training at Stanford University, and postdoctoral research at Columbia University and the National Institutes of Health. We are so pleased to have him here today with us, and we have a wonderful opportunity to chat with him about his experiences and what brought him to the University of Arizona. So thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
I'd just love to have you tell me a little bit first about your impressions of the University of Arizona. Have there been any big surprises since you've been here?
Well, I've said this many times, but the biggest surprise that I've had is how incredibly special the people are. And the passion and dedication that the alums and friends of the university have for the university. A day doesn't go by where someone doesn't come up to me and say, I'm a fourth or fifth generation Wildcat. And I wasn't prepared for that much outpouring of support, and I'm very grateful and humbled to be in this role. As you can see, I was a slow learner. I was in school for a long time, and I couldn't keep a job, but I'm so happy to be here. Hopefully, this is where I'll retire my jersey as a Wildcat.
Well, we hope so, too. But it is an interesting move. Can you talk a little bit about why you wanted to go from hospital administration to running a university?
Yeah, I think that most of what I had done, and certainly at TMC and my positions at Stanford, were really focused more on the academic side and not really running the hospital. The position at TMC was really an education and research position to bring institutions together in a collaborative fashion to improve the health of humanity. And so I'd always been moving toward more of an academic leadership role, and had always wanted to be a university president, and came close several times, but it either wasn't the right person or wasn't the right fit for me. And I'm so glad the opportunities I had before this one that I didn't take them, because I wouldn't have been here. And I believe that in the time of the university, that I'm a good fit for the university, and this is absolutely the best fit of any job I'd ever looked at. So I really love all parts of the university, not just the health science side, which we've got, of course, two medical schools, a great nursing school, pharmacy, and public health school, but every aspect of the university. And as I've made very clear, my goal is going to be focused on undergraduate education, because without students, there's no reason to be a university. We could be a big research center or an education center or a hospital, but without the students, we wouldn't be really be what we are. But also, I am very passionate about research, and we've got one of the best research universities in the entire world, ranked in the top 35 of all universities in the United States, and I love that part of it. I like the fundraising side of things. I like to engage with people, learn their stories, and with faculty. The faculty are just incredible people, great dedicated staff who spent their lives here at this institution. And of course, I love the sports side of things. And I just want to go on record of reminding everyone our football team is undefeated.
We are undefeated. Awesome.
So hopefully I can say that in a few more hours too.
Are there any early leadership lessons that you got as you were building your career?
I think I benefited tremendously from mentors. So I think aspiring leaders need mentors. And I think they also need to be good listeners. And because I was so active in sports, I really believe that leadership is a team sport. You've got to engage people. You've got to provide a vision for them, but you've got to get them to buy in that vision so that you can execute on it. And you can't do it alone. You really do need a team. So I was fortunate to have many mentors in my life. My maternal grandparents raised me. My grandfather was, you know, a community college professor for 47 years. I think when he retired in 1973, he was making $7,800 a year, and he worked afternoons and taught night school and worked on Saturdays at his brother-in-law's furniture store. So I was running around this little campus and sort of gravitated to a lot of mentorship from coaches and teachers. And then, of course, as I was going along through my surgical training, there were many incredible individuals that provided me leadership and mentoring.
And so can you share, when you think about those successful people, what were some of the characteristics that they shared that made them successful?
I think a deep, dedicated passion for whatever they were doing, whether it was running a startup company or running a university or leading a surgical unit or a surgical team. Absolute dedication, passion. Mm-hmm. And the really good ones, as I said, were great coaches. You know, I think had I not done this or been a cardiac surgeon, I would have loved to have been a high school history or science teacher and a coach. So I'm a bit of a frustrated coach, but I think that that focus, that passion, that work ethic, all the things that I think are important to be successful.
So career transitions can be challenging, and you've had several. What was your biggest obstacle in transitioning from working as a cardiac surgeon to a CEO of a large medical center?
That one wasn't as hard as it may seem, because I had stepwise gone through the ranks at Stanford, and I thought I was going to be a dean of a medical school and then eventually be the president of a university. But this opportunity came along in Houston that was really unique. There's no other job like it, because the Texas Medical Center is the largest medical center in the entire world, 59 institutions, and your job is really part-time small-town mayor of a city of about 170,000 individuals, because that's how many students and trainees and employees we had at Texas Medical Center, and part-time Secretary of State, having shuttle diplomacy with the institutions that may be sometimes warring or maybe not getting along very well. And so my job was to come in and really make the sum of the parts greater than the individual parts, and that required leadership and bringing people together. So it was at a higher level, and it was bigger than anything I'd done, but it seemed natural.
Well, and I can see those transitioning here.
Right.
It's the same approach.
It is, but now the great news is I don't have to worry about University of Texas, Texas A&M, University of Houston, who we're playing tonight. Did I mention our team is undefeated? And Rice University, bringing all of them together with MD Anderson, Texas Children's Hospital, Baylor College of Medicine, and trying to articulate a grand vision and then bringing them together and leading them to execute on that vision. Here, you know, I get to focus on one school. I get to be always in red and blue, focused on being a Wildcat. But there are challenges here too. I think that as we go through our strategic planning process over the next year, we're going to have to focus on the things that make us great, and sort of the Wayne Gretzky approach of you need to skate to where you think the puck is going to be, not where the puck is today. And so that's going to require some sacrifices from people. It's going to require having a vision of how we can make the most of the resources that we have, which are, you know, I've always said we're all going to be asked to do more with less in the coming year, because we've had gradual, well, there was one really big cut in state funding for the universities across Arizona, but for all public universities. And so we're going to have to find ways to work together, run the university more efficiently, create new partnerships that will help us be successful. But the fundamental key, I believe, is to have the colleges and the schools work together in a collaborative fashion. And so that's right out of the playbook at a smaller level, but mm-hmm. more intense focus level than what I did in Houston.
That's great. So what advice would you give your 21-year-old self?
Oh, 21, my 21-year-old
yeah.
self. That's so long ago, Melinda, I can't even remember
it
that.
Might be
I'm
something
an old
that,
guy.
That some a current student or young alum in our audience might appreciate.
I would say, you know what, you had the playbook there. I have no regrets. I wouldn't do anything differently. I think that I was so privileged to be able to be a cardiac surgeon at one of the greatest institutions mm-hmm. in the world for so long. And I was able to help patients one patient at a time. I think I'm probably more proud of the fact that I got to, over my 23 years there, be able to train nearly 100 heart surgeons who are literally all over the world. My son, I don't know, he was coming over, I don't know if Clay's here yet, but he got trapped in Singapore the other day because his girlfriend's visa, her passport was going to expire 5 months and 28 days from then, and it has to be 6 months. So they were going to send them all the way back, and so they got, you know, Singapore's not a bad place to be trapped, but after a few days when you're thinking you're going to Bali surfing for a couple of weeks. And I just called up one of my former fellows who's the chief of cardiac surgery in Singapore, and he kind of took care of them. So there are cardiac surgeons all across the world that, trained at Stanford, and I'm really proud of that. And of course, the research discoveries that we made. But in this job, I had influenced 45,000 students
That's right.
every year, and they just keep coming. And, you know, it's our job, I believe, to be good stewards of the resources the state gives the university, but more importantly, the hard-earned money and time and resources that their families, many of whom are first-generation students, have sacrificed to get them here. So we need to help them make the most of the 4 years they have here, and I hope we're starting start talking about 4 years and not 5 or 6 years. It's great. We love having them around, and it's fun to be here. But we can educate people and get them properly trained and get job skills so they can go out in the world and be productive citizens. Tax-paying citizens, and also I think our most important thing we can do is teach them how to be lifelong learners and leaders in their community. So my hope is that we're going to have formalized leadership classes, and I know that's already going on with the Never Settle strategic plan that President Hart put together. The 100% engagement, I think, is tremendous. So, you know, as I transition and I look back, you know, I wish I could have been a little bit, you know, bigger and a little bit faster so I could have actually played college football like I intended to do. And there are a couple of things that I would have done differently, a couple of cases or that I would have done differently that maybe didn't have the outcome I wanted. But for the most part, you know, I've lived an incredibly blessed and joyful life,
awesome.
Culminating in being here
That's
right
great.
Now. It's the
awesome.
Best part of my professional career, bar none.
That's great. So looking around at this university and the things you've learned so far, what do you think it will take to make true meaningful change at a large institution like this?
Well, starting out with, if you chase the money, We've got, as I said before, we've got to figure out how to diversify revenue streams and run the university more efficient, look for more corporate partnerships, get the brightest and best students. And obviously, philanthropy is going to be a really big part of what we do, especially as we go through this strategic planning process over the next year, which I'm looking forward to. It's going to be a lot of hard work, and you know, many people don't like that process. But I tend to like it because the end product is going to be important, but I think the team building that'll be required for all of us to come together and get a meaningful plan will be tremendously important. But I think that we've got to stay focused on the things that are going to be important to our the future of our students and how we can prepare them for this rapidly changing, fast-paced but ever-changing world. You know, it's estimated that students graduating today will have between 10 and 15 jobs in their career, and that kindergartners today, 70% of the jobs that they'll do in their lifetime haven't even been created yet. So I think that, you know, we've got to really focus on bringing the great assets that we have in the university together. I say that oftentimes that we have a team of champions, and what I hope we become is a championship team, so that we all come That's together and work together as a purposeful, meaningful unit.
That's awesome. So I do have a question from the audience that I hope you can answer. So are you a big fan of Grey's Anatomy?
I am. And
yeah.
I
so how accurate is that portrayal of cardiothoracic surgeons?
I think it's probably, it catches the, you know, the drama and interactions amongst staff. It's a little over-dramatized, in my opinion. It's usually a lot less salacious in the real world. And I wasn't going to mention this, but I just got out of the hospital at 9 o'clock this morning. I went in the hospital yesterday, and I watched what was going on, you know, rapidly moving things around me. And, you know, for the most part, it's pretty accurate. You know, they get the words right, but it's a little Hollywoodish. I always loved the old show Saint Elsewhere.
Oh, we break.
That was pretty. I thought that was pretty accurate.
That was well done.
And ER, they got the stuff right, but you know, when they're opening the chest and putting someone on cardiopulmonary bypass while the family's standing there just watching. Yeah.
It didn't happen.
I've never experienced that.
Oh, that's great. So have there been any overriding themes that you've heard from students? You have been so many places since you've started your presidency. Overriding themes from students, alumni, or donors?
Yeah, I keep asking the students, how can we make the university better? And they're so, and I don't know if they're not, you know, in medicine, patients rarely will tell the doctor the real story, but nurses can come in and they sing like birds and they tell them the whole thing. And I think that the students aren't giving me, you know, all the things. Now, there is a small group of students who, you know, they're very demanding and they're very formalized. But when I just walk around across the campus and are able to talk to students, I would say, how could we have made your experience better? And I rarely get any criticisms about how the university is running, that they're able to get their classes they want. They're really proud of being a Wildcat for life. Their degree really means something to them. Now, the faculty, on the other hand, always have very good suggestions. Every one of them has their opinion about how the university should be run, and I listen to everybody. But, you know, you can't make everyone happy, but we'll do the best we can. But I'm really focused on the students, and I think that, there is occasionally some talk about how high the tuition rate is and some of the student fees that have occurred recently, but I rarely get much criticism. So I think that, number one, I'm really proud of the greatness of this university. I underestimated that too. I knew it was a great university, having spent so much time in the Pac-12. I knew it had great sports. I didn't really understand how great the research and the science was, and how great the students and the education they're getting. I mean, we're getting incredibly, 90%+ satisfaction from employers about our students being ready to go into the workforce. And I think at the end of the day, I think about education the same way as healthcare. We've got to provide a value, which is the highest quality education at the lowest cost with the best service to our students. And I think we're doing a really good job, but I hope we're going to improve, and this strategic planning process will give us some of the changes in curriculum that I think we need to deliver the education more effectively. This is a long-winded answer, but there is a group of professors here who are focused on this integrated team approach to learning. So if you go in their classrooms, I went into a classroom of chemical engineering students the first day of class, and the professor told me that he is all in on, for the last 3 or 4 years, been teaching this immersive team collaborative approach of education, not just stand up here with slides. Studies have said after about 15 or 20 minutes, you lose people if you're just giving them death by PowerPoint. And so this approach is really interactive. It's peer-to-peer learning. He uses these clickers to answer questions and keep people involved. So I'd hope to see that across the entire university. And he said for this chemical engineering course, the dropout rate or the fail rate of this class nationwide is 50%. And for his class in the last 3 or 4 years, it's been 8%.
Wow.
And I said, well, that means you're being too easy. You're giving easy tests and not grading them very hard. And he said, they're all of my former students who are now TAs here. You go ask them if it was hard or not. And then I said, well, give me the hardest question you would ask on the final exam. And of course, I had no idea what he was talking about. So I thought it was pretty hard, actually.
So from what you've seen, are you still embracing the student engagement, the 100% student engagement?
Absolutely, without question. I think that is going to be something that we'll carry forward from Never Settle. And Never Settle was good. It's just a time for us to rethink, a new president being here, a new time. And we will take away a lot of great things from Never Settle, and 100% engagement is one I love.
That's
so we'll
awesome.
Keep that.
Good. That's great. So impressions at all about the Alumni Association or the alumni world in general? You've been great to travel to several of our pockets of alumni to talk with them.
Yeah, I've experienced many different alumni groups, and you know, my son, if he shows up, he's a 14 graduate of Dartmouth, and they've got an incredible alumni network. I mean, they absolutely bleed green. And I think, though, that our network is, first of all, it's bigger. Second of all, I believe our alumni are as passionate as anybody in the country. So, you know, oftentimes the Block A is your symbol and it's out there, and I think it's got real global brand power, and it is because of the alumni and the people who are so dedicated to the university. I mean, you know, there are Ohio State, Michigan, Notre Dame, USC. There are a lot of great alumni groups, but I would put ours right up there with anybody, especially when it comes around to basketball season. We travel well.
We do travel
well. We're very
well.
Successful, and this is going to be the year. I'm not going to go out on a, you know, because I've kind of overstated the sports thing too much, but I told Coach Rodriguez, well, I told all the coaches and all the athletes, our goal every year should be win the national championship in every sport we have. Now, that's not going to be realistic, but I think this year in basketball it could be. This could be the year that we get that, you know, highly elusive second national championship. But I'd love for the football team to win a national championship. Here's what I would really be hopeful that we can get to the Rose Bowl because I didn't realize that
happy alumni.
And so I think the alumni has been absolutely tremendous, very hospitable, welcoming, and supportive, and I'm really appreciative of that.
That's great. Well, I know you have a very busy day today. Football game, tailgate. I know you're going to be out there talking to a lot of our alumni who are on the mall, so we appreciate you being here today.
Thank you for inviting me, and I'm trying to be a little calmer because I got a long day today.
Thank you so much for joining us in our as our cat in the corner office.
Great. Thank you so much.